Namaskar and welcome to In Focus. Now, the law minister in most governments is usually an unknown figure who doesn't attract much attention. Not so the present incumbent. He's not only in the center of many controversies, but truth be told, he seems to revel in it. But is Ramakant Khalap a misunderstood man, or is there more to him than meets the eye? Here to answer those questions is the law minister himself. Mr. Khalap, let me come straight to the point and touch on the issue I've just raised. Are you a misunderstood man, or does the press have good reason for doubting you?
I think I'm both a little bit misunderstood and also well understood by so many.
But you said both to the other half being, does the press have good reasons to doubt you?
Well, they might have, I don't know. I leave it to them.
Matlab aap kehne ke thodi chalaki karni ho to kar leta hu main.
Achha kariye aap.
लेकिन
मैं भी करूंगा कुछ हो सके तो
आप करते हैं चलाकी
चलेंगे
चलिए फिर मैं आपकी चलाकी के बारे में पूछना चाहता हूं let me begin with a simple issue which has been in the news recently. When you have to choose the new Chief Justice of India, will you go by the customary and established principle of appointing the senior most judge of the Supreme Court?
इसमें मैं साफ साफ कहूंगा कोई चलाकी इसमें नहीं रहेगी. जो आज तक का प्रेसिडेंट है, जो लॉ कहता है, उसी के माफक आई विल गो अहेड.
और मुझे बताइए वो प्रेसिडेंट है क्या?
प्रेसिडेंट तो ऐसा है जो सीनियर मोस्ट जो जज रहता है सुप्रीम कोर्ट में.
सो द सीनियर मोस्ट जज ऑफ द सुप्रीम कोर्ट
विल दैट इज द प्रेसिडेंट टुडे. दैट्स व्हाट आई सेड.
ओके, सो जस्ट लेट्स बी एब्सोल्युटली क्लियर. ऑन द डे चीफ जस्टिस अहमदी रिटायर्स, इफ जस्टिस वर्मा इज द सीनियर मोस्ट जज, ही विल सक्सीड हिम.
दैट इज द लॉ टुडे एंड आई एम अ लॉ मिनिस्टर, मिनिस्टर फॉर लॉ एंड जस्टिस. आई वुडंट कॉज एनी इनजस्टिस टू एनीबॉडी.
And you will abide
not
by...
Not to any individual, not to the system.
Now, the reason I raise this is two major publications, The Statesman and Sunday Magazine, have both raised doubts about whether you're going to follow this precedent.
Shayad ye chalaki ki baat hogi unki.
Lekin wo doubt kyun raise kar rahe hain aapke baare?
Kyun kahe, kyun kar rahe hain? Isme thoda spicy banta hai news reading.
Magar main aapko ye sawal ek baar phir puchna chahta hoon. Can you imagine any circumstances in which you might not follow this precedent?
What are the circumstances? Come on, if you can tell me there are any circumstances exist which should force me to deviate from the well-known path. At least nothing of this nature has come forward.
Aap keh rahe hain ki agar mujhe deviate karna hoga to main kar lunga.
Aap bataiye na, aise koi reasons hai kya?
Khalap sahab,
aapke man mein agar koi aise reasons hai, statesman ke man mein koi reasons hai, let those reasons come out.
The reasons that are often quoted in the newspaper articles I'm talking about is that your government is doubtful of Justice Verma because he is perhaps one of the most active judges when it comes to prosecuting politicians.
Absolutely not. This is, you know, an attempt is being made to create some sort of a scare, not only in the mind of Justice Verma, but probably in the entire judicial system in our country. No doubt, talks are there all over. Everybody is talking about the judiciary. Everybody is talking about the government. That does not mean that the government is going to just knock down the established principles. Why should we? And I have been on record saying from day one that we hold the judiciary in the highest respect. Not only we, I also expect the press to hold the judiciary in the highest respect. I expect the entire country to hold the judiciary in the highest respect.
It's because
and then we say not anything, we publish not anything which would create a scare, which would create some sort of a apprehension in the minds of the people.
Law Minister, it's because we all hold the judiciary in the highest respect that I want you once again to clarify your position in this matter. Many people hearing the beginning of this interview will have heard you parrying words with me, replying with another question to my question. So let me remove all doubt and ask you the question one last time. When Chief Justice Ahmadi retires, if Justice Verma is the senior most judge of the Supreme Court, will he succeed him as Chief Justice?
Yes, I repeat that. He will be.
Then just one simple question. This is a very clear, categorical answer. Why haven't you given this earlier?
What was the reason?
Two major publications.
You want to, I have a question to ask you also now, as perhaps representing the press. If you, for no reason, absolutely, there was no reason at all to raise this question for anybody, raise such a question and expect me to answer it, is it a proper way of going about?
You might have been right, Law Minister.
There was no reason whatsoever.
The first time round the question was raised, there may have been no reason to answer it. But when it's been raised by at least two major publications, perhaps even more, then it becomes an issue in itself.
There is nothing of the sort whatsoever at any time in anybody's mind. Unnecessarily, a controversy appears to me is being created. An entire suspicious atmosphere seems to be created by people. I don't know what.
My last question on this, because I don't really want to add to the suspicion, but my last question on this, do you think by not clarifying the matter earlier, you've clarified it today, but by not clarifying it earlier, you might have fueled the suspicion?
We have not. We have not. At least I didn't see any reason to answer anything or clarify, so as you say, on this issue, because this was not at all called for. Nobody ever dreamt of it.
Do you feel in that case that the press and whoever else has raised this issue has treated you unfairly?
Well, I leave it to you, to your judgment.
No,
I wouldn't express any opinion on that. I leave it to you.
By not expressing an opinion, you're suggesting to me that, in fact, you're hurt by the way people have ever thought you might not do the right thing.
Well, in this particular case, you see, I really feel a bit hurt. A bit hurt because the manner in which this sort of a cloud was sought to be created about the entire thing. You know, it did hurt us. It hurt not only us, it hurt the judiciary also. It hurt everybody.
And it hurt you personally too?
Personally too. What cause, what reason do we have?
So when I began by saying you were a misunderstood man, in this one area you were misunderstood.
Once again, to say that I was misunderstood, I must have said something to be misunderstood. I didn't say a word to anybody on this issue. Nobody ever raised this issue anywhere.
Okay,
why should I have been misunderstood? I would on the contrary say that somebody created some sort of a story, published it, had it discussed, had it repeatedly said about it, and then say there the law minister doesn't answer this question. This is not a question of misunderstanding. I would say creating an understanding of a different nature.
All right. You've clarified this issue. You've told us categorically that when Chief Justice Ahmadi retires, if Justice Verma is the senior most judge, he will succeed him. That's right?
You okay? What more do you want me to say
okay.
on this?
Let's move to another issue, because let's try and see if we can clarify that as well. Looking back with hindsight, do you think perhaps you were ill-advised, perhaps you were wrong in instructing the CBI not to oppose Narasimha Rao's bail?
I am very clear on this issue, both in terms of law, in terms of propriety, in terms of exercising my own whatever powers that I have as Minister for Law.
You weren't wrong?
I was not wrong. I am not wrong in this issue.
And even with the benefit of hindsight, you would have still done the same thing today?
Yes, even today I would have done that.
Then let's look at some of the issues that arise. To begin with, on what basis were you issuing these instructions? The CBI doesn't report to you.
Well, I'm Minister for Justice, Law and Justice, mind you that. And as Minister for Justice, every ministry approaches my ministry.
For advice, not instructions.
For advice.
So this.
What do you mean by advice and instructions? If you want to play on the words, you mean, well, jolly well, you can go ahead and do it. But then, the questions are like this. What is the advice in the given circumstances? You read it as instructions, you read it as advice, you read it the way you want it.
The CBI administratively reports to the PMO, and if I understand the Delhi Special Police Establishment Act, it only refers to the PMO in certain very specific instances. Those don't include having to observe the advice given in this connection.
Well, you may say so that they go to the PMO, they go to whatever, you know, each ministry, maybe approaching whichever other ministry they're supposed to be approaching. But as I said, Law Ministry is at the center of every other ministry. Legal issues arise from time to time. It could be Defense Ministry, it could be Telecommunications Ministry, it could be Agriculture Ministry, you name it. And they come to the Law Ministry for advice.
Ji haan,
for clarification they come. They want to know how, given facts.
Khalap Saab, you've just used two important words. They come for advice, they come for clarification. So you were giving advice, clarification, not instructions.
Well, that's what I'm telling you. You can use any type of the word you want.
No, but it was said
you
in the papers.
Treat
you,
advice,
had
you can treat advice as, clarification. You can use it, say it as instruction.
There's a difference between instruction and advice, isn't there? Advice can be rejected. Instructions cannot be, because that becomes disobeyed.
Karanji. Well, you seem to be on a.
आप कौन सा दे रहे थे?
You seem to be going on a path.
नहीं मतलब मैं पूछ रहा हूँ.
Going round and round about it, but the fact of the case is very simple. Let us come to the very case itself. Why don't you come to that case?
No, I've come to that
going around.
मैं आपको ये पूछ रहा हूँ. आप अड़ने आ रहा हूँ मैं. पर मुझे ये पहले बताइएगा. आप एडवाइस दे रहे थे या इंस्ट्रक्शंस?
The way you take it.
No.
Government's advice given by the law ministry amounts to instructions for the other ministries in number of cases. Of course, it doesn't mean that they always have to abide by it.
You're saying that you expected the public prosecutor to accept your advice as instructions.
You look here. It was the CBI with which I was talking. I was not talking to the counsel.
All right.
I was not talking
you
to the counsel.
You expected the CBI to accept your advice as instructions.
And inform their lawyers accordingly.
In which case, let me quote to you something which I'm sure as law minister you're well aware of. The Supreme Court has certain obiter dicta, if that's the correct phrase, referring to how public prosecutors are to be treated.
Right.
And I'll quote one of them. It says, next in importance to the independence of the tribunal is the integrity of the person in charge of the prosecution, namely the public prosecutor. Was not your advice, oblique instruction, tampering with that integrity?
Certainly not. Certainly not. The Supreme Court judgment does not at all say that the public prosecutors should not speak to the government, should not speak to the executive. It is not said anywhere so.
It says also,
look, it's very simple. A public prosecutor does occupy a little different position. His integrity, his independence has to be obtained, has to be maintained. But it is for the government to tell their lawyers, this is what we feel in a given case. How he uses that, it's for him to decide. In the setup that we have,
this is very interesting. Forgive me interrupting. When you say how he uses that is for him to decide, are you suggesting he had the right to refuse to abide?
Certainly. He can. The lawyer can always say, well, these are the set of instructions I've received. You know, mind you, when I use the word instruction, I use it in relation to a client.
Sure.
So instructing his lawyer.
I think you said something important, Mr., which is why I'm interrupting you. Forgive me. You're saying that he had the right to hear your advice, refuse to accept it, and to continue to conduct the case exactly as he wanted.
It's up to him.
So he need not
have... The instructions which are given in a given case, this is what the perception that the government has, or the client has. Let me put it in that very plain language. A client has his own perceptions about a given set of things. But these perceptions are carried on, are forwarded to the lawyer. In a normal case, where the private parties are engaged there, it's for the clear case of discussion takes place. In case of a public prosecutor, when these instructions, if you want to use that particular word, or advice, which I would use, or our opinion, or our perception of a particular thing, are transferred, are given, forwarded to the lawyer concerned, or the public prosecutor in this case, he sifts it, he examines it within the available legal position before him. His own, he weighs it against his own perception. He may disagree and say, okay, I don't accept this. I will proceed in this particular fashion. He can go.
This is very interesting. What you're saying is that Mr. Subramaniam actually had another alternative other than resigning. He resigned because he felt it would be wrong not to oppose bail. However, you're now saying he didn't have to resign. He could have rejected the advice and continued to pursue the cases
certainly,
he wanted.
Certainly. It was very clear for him, open for him.
So in fact, it was an overreaction on his part resigning.
I wouldn't comment anything on that. I say our perception in a given case was that
Mr. Kalap, you've just said
bail need not be objected. This was our perception. About
and
this.
You're also saying that that advice, because you're insisting it's advice,
yes,
could have been rejected and the public prosecutor could have continued in the case.
Right.
Could Mr. Have. Kalap, could have. That very important point, I'm afraid we have to take a commercial break. I want to continue this discussion later
okay,
on. We'll be back in just a couple of minutes. Don't go away. We've got a lot more that's going to be just as interesting to follow. Welcome back to part two of our interview with Ramakant Kalap. Minister, we were talking in part one and actually you were clarifying misunderstandings about two positions that you've taken and you've done it very effectively. Let me now draw you out on a general background, which is the backdrop against which not only these decisions were taken, but much of your government is functioning. Do you accept that what the press refers to as judicial proactivism is in a sense sparked off by the failure of a succession of political executives, both at the center and the state, to fulfill their functions?
Basically, we have to understand that over the last few years, with the plethora of laws that we have around, the expectations of the people did not really materialize on a large many issues. And people were forced to go to the courts to get relief for their grievances. And in these cases, the courts have come to the rescue of the people at large on some very large, important public issues. This has been viewed as activism, or whatever you call it. Well, I feel this process is a process of evolution of the legal system in our country. It is necessary to some extent. Look at our laws, municipal laws, look at our revenue laws, which provide for certain actions to be taken by the government. There's a correlation between what action is to be taken, the amount of money that is required to be spent on that. And also you have to look at the people who are supposed to implement these laws. There has been a mismatch. You have to accept this. Now, when there's a mismatch and one section of society suffers on account of it, well, they need some platform where to go and express their grievances.
You sound very understanding and extremely sympathetic towards judicial activism.
I am to some extent, yeah.
You're a supporter of it.
I am a supporter, yes.
Many of your legislative colleagues are deeply critical. You don't share their criticism.
Look, what they're critical of, you also have to understand. Some legislators, some politicians, if you want to call it, why, some media men also feel that certain pronouncements of the judiciary are not in the nature of judicial activism, but they are in the nature of judicial expansionism. I use this word.
What is the difference between...
I don't want to distinguish between one or two.
But why? Words. If you're using it, you have to.
I have used it, but I don't say I use it in my own way. But this is how people have looked at it.
Is that how you look at it?
I don't look at it in that particular fashion. There may be a particular case, well, which you can always disagree with the judgment.
Let me probe your position, because you're not just law minister, you're a lawyer, and you're a very articulate thinking person. How far do you support judicial activism?
I support it to the extent that it explains the law. I support it to the extent that it amounts to implementation of the existing provisions of law. I do not support it if it transgresses upon the rights of the sovereignty of the house.
Give me an example where you think this...
Well, it's difficult to give an example of this nature.
Let me give you an example then.
Okay.
Do you think that Judge Dhingra's sweeping remarks about the political tribe as a whole was an example of transgression?
That has been already discussed, that judgment.
It was struck down as well by
the
High Court.
It has been discussed. So that doesn't require any further comment.
So that's a non-controversial example of transgression.
Exactly.
Okay,
exactly.
Let's now come up with examples that haven't been discussed. Do you think that Justice Usha Mehra's attempt to initiate a public interest litigation and then allocate it to her own court, which the Chief Justice of the Delhi High Court disagreed with, do you think that is a transgression?
Let's wait exactly to weigh the pros and cons of all such matters. When any such thing happens, naturally eyebrows are raised that a particular judge raises the question herself and takes it before her for judgment.
So that's clearly expansionism, isn't
it? I wouldn't call it expansionism as such. But these are where, you know, the matter of propriety once again comes. Well, should I be the prosecutor and I should be the judge of the same case?
What about the Patna High Court's decision asking the CBI to circumvent their own director and report directly, or the Delhi High Court appointing members of the CBI as officers of the court?
We objected to it. I went in the Supreme Court against that.
Yes, one got struck down, but reporting...
Patna case, we went up...
But the Delhi High Court hasn't been struck down.
No, we haven't gone to the Supreme Court on that issue.
So you've accepted it?
We haven't accepted it as such. We haven't accepted it. But once again here, there's a difference between the two cases.
Is it what you would call expansionism?
Well, not exactly expansionism, but here what we thought was that this order of directing a particular officer to report to the court, bypassing the senior officers in the CBI hierarchy, would amount to sort of not only just demoralizing, but creating a sort of a fermenting sort of a dissension between the various...
Precisely. So why did you not go to a higher court in appeal against this?
We have gone, I told you, in Patna High Court against Patna High Court.
But not against the Delhi High Court?
Not against the Delhi High Court, but there, once again, it's a different issue. Concessions were there on the part of the government in that particular case.
Concessions to
in the sense that, as the judgment reads, if you go by the was whatever stated in the judgment, you will read there, that on our part, on the government part, it was an offer was made to the court, that court may treat these people as officers of the court, and they report directly to the court.
So in other words, this was an element of activism, oblique expansionism you were prepared to accept?
No, what I say there is...
You even initiated
it. It's not the judicial inroad, but it was sort of our own part, the government.
Let me put something to Mr. Khala. Many people hearing this part of the interview are going to say to themselves, his position on judicial expansionism versus judicial activism seems confused. Is that because the government itself hasn't learned to distinguish between the two? Or is it because as a lawyer, this is a very tricky subject for you to talk about?
No, one thing, look here, it's a very simple thing. You cannot generalize the issues. You cannot generalize. You have to look at a case. Case by case study has to be done. There are judgments and judgments. In certain cases, as I said, activism is required because the judiciary has to be vibrant. Not only judiciary, every organ of the government, of the democracy has to be very vibrant.
And in other cases, it's not.
Well, it's not that. But while being vibrant, you have to see that you don't move your place and then intrude on some other's realm.
So sometimes...
So long as that doesn't happen, okay.
Is this intrusion when it happens deliberate or is it overzealousness?
It may be overzealousness. It may be, well, deliberate if you want to call. But then this will be imputing a motive to the judiciary.
Okay, let me then turn and ask you the opposite of what I've been pursuing. All these cases where judicial activism have happened are very high-profile cases. They usually concern extremely prominent politicians, either of today or of yesterday. What about the backlog of cases that's absolutely clogging up the judicial system? The judges don't seem to care about that. And you know the phrase, justice delayed is justice denied.
This is what I was expecting all the way to ask me this question. Because more than what so-called activism that is going on, or expansionism, whichever term you want to use in this case, what is required more is to bring solace to the teeming millions of our country. 2.5 crore cases pending in our courts at different levels. What is being done to tackle those? This is a question I asked not only the judiciary, I asked it to myself.
But when you ask the judiciary, what do they say?
Well, judiciary says, well, the number of cases are increasing day by day.
But why don't
the system is such.
Why don't they show some activism clearing up this backlog?
Well, they have shown to some extent. It is not that they have not.
Look at what the Human Rights Committee of the Bihar legislature said. Most sub-magistrates and district magistrates in Bihar refuse to attend court.
It's a very bad situation if it so exists. But some judges, some courts have taken up the issue and tried to find a solution to it.
Have you had a private word with the Chief Justice to try and push this?
I have been talking.
What is his response?
He's very cooperative with this.
Verbally cooperative?
Not only verbally. Look at the Supreme Court. The number of cases pending in the Supreme Court today are just about 28,000.
So you think...
What was the situation about a year back? What was the situation about 2 years back?
So in fact, what you're saying is you don't have cause for complaint in this area?
No. They have. Supreme Court has done very commendable work in this case. They have reduced their backlog to just about 28,000. Annual cases, number of cases which are filed in the Supreme Court themselves are about somewhere around 28,000.
So what you're saying really is you have no...
So whatever that has been done by the Supreme Court, what I want now is now that this particular system adopted by the Supreme Court must percolate down. The Chief Justice of the various high courts must take up, must study what the Supreme Court has done.
Are they doing it?
Well, I hope they're doing it.
Are they doing it at a speed that you think is satisfactory?
Oh, I don't find the speed with which they could have
gone. Have you spoken to them about it?
I've not spoken as such, but you know, the discussions that are going on in different places, I expect the Supreme Court itself to take it over. And they had a conference of the Chief Justices here very recently.
So you're hoping?
Probably they have discussed this issue also.
But essentially, you're still hoping?
Yes, you can see. There I can...
You still want...
I almost
action has to be taken, you're still relying
much
on hope.
Much more work is required to be done at the High Court level, at the subordinate court level.
Okay, Law Minister, on that point of what sounds like oblique criticism, I'm afraid we're going to have to end this interview. Thank you very much for talking so openly to InFocus. That's it for this week. We'll be back next week with another interviewee. But for today, bye-bye.